Welcome to the teaching ministry of David T. Demola. Open your heart to receive as Pastor Demola teaches the uncompromised Word of God.
I want to bring you on a journey today, something a little different. I want to give you some history, some background, and then tie it all together in a few minutes in what I believe will be helpful to you to make certain that your testimony of Jesus is secure in your life today. Just a couple of verses found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21. Just want to read a couple of verses, and then I'm going to begin to take you on a journey today. You ready to go on that journey with me? Yes. Matthew chapter 21, please, and verse 8. We're picking it up right in the middle of a narrative, and it's important that you understand where I'm going to go, but these verses point out where I'm headed in the direction today. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Now obviously we get Palm Sunday from these scripture verses because the branches that were spread were literally palm branches. But it wouldn't make a difference if they were palm tree branches or if they were branches from a Scotch pine tree. It wouldn't make a difference. The principal point and truth of the whole thing is Jesus was coming into Jerusalem on the Sunday before his final death on Calvary, and that would be a week later. And I want to bring you through a whole bunch of things today, and I would ask your indulgence that you really understand that I'm going to take you on a journey, and it may seem like it's going to nowhere, but in the end, it will come back to where we need to go. Jesus is entering into Jerusalem in a triumph on Palm Sunday. But we know, because we know the future, that what happened with Jesus on that Palm Sunday, we know this, that it was just a week later where his triumphant entry would actually end up in a horrible scene at a place called Golgotha, Calvary, the skull. But what an interesting thing, because as you understand a little bit of history, you find out several things about this whole story. We're going to find out where the Hosanna in the highest came from. And why did they say, thou son of David? It's very interesting that you understand this. And I'll tell you this in case I forget to say it as I move along. But in relating to Hosanna to the son of David, David represented a kingdom, a time when they were strong, when they were militarily strong. So when they said Hosanna to the son of God, to the son of David, they were referring back to something that they thought was going to happen when Jesus triumphantly entered Jerusalem, and that was a military takeover. Remember that. Put that in the back of your mind. Everybody say, I'm putting it back in my mind. Come on. So we have to understand what went wrong from Sunday to Friday that Jesus would enter with such pomp and circumstance and end up being crucified on an old rugged cross. How interesting that is. Hopefully we'll find out some of the background today. One of the intriguing things that I have found out in my study over the last number of weeks, as I've been searching through this, is that that was not the only procession on that day that took place in Jerusalem. If they'll bring up the title of my message today, you'll see what I'm going to be talking about. How interesting to find out that this was a tale of two processions. Most casual Bible readers who never indulge in any history at all do not know what actually happened on that Sunday that Jesus was coming in. Jesus was coming into Jerusalem on the east side of the city, but on the west side of the city, there was another parade that was going on, and this one was contrastingly different than what was happening with Jesus. The city of Jerusalem at that time was about 50,000 strong. But during the Passover season, which is what is happening in this narrative, the city would swell up to maybe even 1 million people. People would gather from all of the provinces and come to celebrate this famous holiday of Jewish Passover that was celebrated in the city of Jerusalem. That holiday celebrated an intriguing event in the history of the Jewish people. It was commemorative of something that happened when they were under siege and bondage in Egypt for all of those 400 plus years. The Passover was the final thing that happened in Egypt, if you can remember that. They were to eat the lamb that was roasted. They were to take the blood from the sacrifice and sprinkle it on the lintels and doorposts. And that night when the angel of death passed over, it was not going to touch those houses, and they were going to be freed. And forever, they were supposed to celebrate that. How interesting that in the 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, they only celebrated it once they came out of Egypt, but never did it for 40 years. But every year they would celebrate it. And now the Passover was more than just a commemoration of what happened in Egypt. Now it had become an event that would take place like we would think of today, like a big fair that would come to town. A big event, a circus event almost like. Yes, there were sacrifices, and yes, there were religious people, but primarily it was just another time for people to gather in Jerusalem. So picture Jerusalem now, infused with multitudes of people. On the narrow streets of Jerusalem, people have gathered from all of the provinces around to come out and celebrate the Passover. And so now God, in his remarkable timetable, is now allowing Jesus to come into that city at the time of Passover. After all, now we know that Jesus was truly the Passover lamb. Come on, I need a little help right now. But on the other side of the city, on the west side, there was another parade going on. How interesting that most people never know this. It is now historically proven that on that day, the governor of Judea, Pontius Pilate, was leading a procession of Roman cavalry and centurions into the city of Jerusalem. Imagine the spectacle of that entry. Here comes Pontius Pilate with Roman soldiers on horseback and on foot. Each soldier clad in leather armor polished to a high gloss. On each centurion's head, hammered helmets gleaming in the bright sunlight of Jerusalem. At their sides, sheathed with swords crafted from the hardest steel. And in their hands, the centurion was carrying a spear. Or if he was an archer, he would have arrows across his back, and he would look at as an incredible person to be feared by anybody who would look at them. Drummers were beating out a cadence of march that was no ordinary entry into Jerusalem, because Pilate, as the governor of the region, which included not only Judea and Samaria, but all the surrounding areas, knew that it was a standard practice for the Roman governor or of a foreign territory to be in its capital for religious celebrations. Why would they come into the city for religious celebrations? To make sure that during the time when people would be excited about their religion, that they would not become insurrectionists or terrorists, and they would rebel against the government. They would rise up like in past history and try to overthrow the then Roman government. So Rome had to show its authority, had to show its power. After all, as the beginning of the Passover, this festival could not be allowed to turn into anything other than just a celebration of something, but nothing that would have to do with political takeover or anything that would oppose the government of Rome. Is everybody tracking with me right now? Come on. How many is tracking with me? Come on. So Pilate had to be in Jerusalem. Since the Romans had occupied this land by defeating the Jews and deposing their king 80 years before, uprisings were always in the air. The last major uprising, long before Pilate's time, had been after the death of Herod the Great in 4 BC. Now it was 30 AD. And now they're afraid. The uprising had taken place in the past. And over all of those years, history now tells us that there were at least 2,000 Jews that had been crucified because of insurrection against the Roman government. I want you to think about that for a minute. Crucifixion to those people was nothing out of the ordinary. It was something they saw all the time, especially around the times of feasts, where there was always a fear that something would happen to overtake the government that was now in authority and power. 2,000 plus Jews have been crucified because they have been revolutionaries against Rome and against authority. Is everybody with me so far? Come on. So the Romans had no tolerance towards anybody that would come into that area. They were being watched. As a matter of fact, where the Passover was celebrated was in the central temple. And right next door, there was the place where the Roman soldiers were. It is called Antonius Fortress. That would overlook the central synagogue, the temple, where the people would sacrifice as the Passover was taking place. And all the Roman soldiers had their eyes on all the Jews to make sure that nobody would come against the government. We're talking about people under siege. Even though the town would have had swollen to almost 1 million people, yet they were being watched. And the show of authority, the show of power by the Roman government made people realize, you better not get out of line because we've got enough military here to put you down and to take care of you. Are you with me so far? If you are, say amen. The day of two processions. Pilate comes in on a horse, a white stallion, surrounded by Roman soldiers, centurions, specifically trained, incredible warriors. Jesus is coming in on the east side of Jerusalem. And he's not coming on a white horse. He's coming on a donkey. Talk to me, somebody. Come on. A contrast. There are no soldiers around him. All that is around him probably are the people that have followed in his ministry. Because along the way, Jesus has attracted certain individuals. I'm sure that if you were one of the people in the crowd that Jesus had healed, you would have been following him. I'm sure if you would have been a lame person that now is walking, you would have been following him. I'm sure that if you were a blind person that was now seeing, you would have been following him. I'm sure that if you were there when he served a little boy's lunch to almost 20,000 people, you would have been following him. I'm sure if you had seen him walk on the water, you would have been following him. I'm sure that if you would have seen him perform all of these miracles, you would have been in the crowd of his followers. But even though he had followers, he also had opposition. Now, do you know why people were throwing branches at his feet? Because years before, the Maccabeans had conquered Jerusalem. And when they conquered Jerusalem and got into power, the Maccabeans were those political Jews who wanted to take authority and power into their own hands. Remember now that Israel as a nation still existed under the law of Moses, but yet many had now forsaken the actual real law and had began to live under this Pharisaical code, and so it became more of a religious system than a relationship with God. Oh, you got to talk to me a little bit. Am I boring you with statistics so far? If I am, then you need to be wakened up by somebody near you because I'm taking you somewhere. Tell somebody next to you, say, he's going somewhere. Now we know that all of what was happening by this show of Roman power was because history had said that in the past, when they conquered the authorities and powers under that Maccabean timetable, there was the throwing of palm branches. There was the relationship back to David. David's kingdom was a strong kingdom. There was no military might in the whole world that could come against David's kingdom. I want you to think about that for a minute. Every battle was won because God was on David's side. But Israel now had lost its intimate relationship with God and had swung towards the political arena to correct the ills that were going on in society. I came here today to tell you this. We will never solve the problems of our nation with political power. I don't care who's in power in Washington. That is not what's going to solve our problems in this country. There is no political resolution to a spiritual problem. I want you to tap your neighbor and tell him, I know what he's talking about. Yeah. And so we now understand that Rome was afraid that another insurrectionist was going to be raised up. I'll tell you, the devil's a liar. Amen. Somebody shout to me, the devil's a liar. I want you to say it like you have conviction about it. Here comes Jesus, and here comes the arm of man. One from the west, one from the east. And by the way, that is the West here, and that is the East. Jesus is coming on a donkey. Pilate is coming on a white horse. Jesus has disciples. Pilate has Roman soldiers. And everything is being watched, lest out of this crowd of people, people would rise up against Roman authority and mess everything up. Still with me?
Yes.
And so Jesus comes in. Hosanna on the highest. Hosanna to the King. Watch this. Hosanna to the King. Oh, but the only difference is Jesus wasn't coming as a king. Jesus was coming as a servant. You're not tracking with me. Yeah. Jesus didn't come to sit on a throne. He wasn't coming as a revolutionary. Oh, he was a revolutionary, but not a political revolutionary. He had come to revolutionize all of the religious systems that were going on. He had come as the savior of mankind. That's why he didn't come on a white horse. A white horse was the symbol of a king. He came on a donkey, which was the symbol of a servant. And I want to tell you, in the kingdom of God, if you're ever going to get anywhere, you got to get off your high horse and get on a donkey. Yeah. So they were watching the crowd, watching the temple, making sure no one was going to upset their religious system. Making sure that nobody would rattle the cage, come against Roman authority and Roman power. What a contrast between kingdoms, one on display of power and one on display of the presence of Almighty God. No wonder why they said, hail to the King, hail to the King, to the King. They didn't want to see him as a servant. Jesus said, I didn't come to earth to be nothing than a servant to you. And he that would be greatest of all, let him serve. So he starts out with a lot of followers. And the more he gets into the city, now he's among all the Pharisees. And don't you know it's the Pharisees that rebuke Jesus when they're crying out, "Hail to the King, Hosanna to the highest." The Pharisees turned to Jesus and said, "You need to rebuke them. You need to tell them, cut this out. You're not really a king." No, he's not the king in Jerusalem. He's the king of glory. So it's an interesting week. It's an interesting week because now Jesus has picked up admirers along the way. Now he's picked up antagonists, people who are against him. And we're going to find out, not today, but next week as we deal more into this. This is a two-part message, that once you understand who Jesus is, you either have to stand for him or you stand against him. There is no middle ground. Jesus now is right in the middle of all of the Passover. The Pharisees are now against him. And his followers now are being swayed by an unbelieving crowd. Ooh, I wish I could get off into the weeds right here. But let me just say this. You cannot be swayed by an unbelieving crowd in your office, in your family, in your community, or even in our nation. You cannot be swayed by political people that want to tell you it's this way or that way. And I want to tell you that during the season that Jesus now comes into Jerusalem, something drastic happened. Because now they are so angry at him that this was a setup that God was bringing. Because the only way that Jesus could go to Calvary is he had to be falsely accused. He could not be justly accused because he didn't do anything wrong. But he is now falsely accused. And in order for him to go there, it has to be a setup. Jesus is now at a place where everybody is convinced the king is coming to set up his kingdom. We're going to be out of Roman authority from now on. We're going to have our own system back like King Solomon, like King David. Notice, Hosanna to the king who comes like King David. Because all I could think of is, ooh, when we were under David's rule, everything was free and everything was great. They were convinced that Jesus was not just a miracle worker, but that Jesus had come as their king to set up an earthly kingdom. Amen. Stick with me, please. Tell your neighbor, say, stick with them, stick with them, stick with them. I'm not where I gotta be, but I'm getting closer. Come on. Jesus is accused. And he's now brought by Pilate before the angry mobs. They want to get rid of him. Jesus, in their minds, never did what they wanted him to do. He never defeated the Romans. He never dissolved the unfair tax system. He never put common people in charge of the government. And furthermore, they knew he never would. To appease the crowds of the swelling city of Jerusalem, Pilate had the custom of releasing prisoners, many of whom were political prisoners. But on the last week of the life of Jesus, Pilate offers the crowd a choice between Barabbas, everybody say Barabbas, Barabbas, a known robber, and Jesus, a failed Messiah. Fearing that if Jesus were released, he would start all over again. The crowd begged for Barabbas. And here's where the story gets interesting. I'm ready to preach. How many know how long I've been doing this? On June the 29th, it will actually be 59 years that I'm preaching.
Hallelujah.
And I never knew what I'm about to tell you. So don't you ever think you know everything. I want you to turn on your antennas right now. Everybody put your antennas up like this. I went back and did an intense study of Barabbas. Not a Hollywood version. What's the name Barabbas? The first three letters, B-A-R, bar, mean what? Son. And in that name, Abbas, is the word Abba, father. It seems to be that in history, Barabbas was raised in a family that was religious. And it actually could be that his family was training him to be a leader eventually in the synagogue. And so henceforth, the name of son of my father. The father might have been a religious leader. So Barabbas was going to be, in the strain of his father, a religious leader in the synagogue. Trained to be somebody who would bring religious freedom and victory to the Jews. Imagine how the devil is a liar. Watch this. That he would have in the city of Jerusalem at the same time when the Son of God is coming into the city, a man with a false narrative whose name was the Son of the Father. You didn't get that, but somebody did. But now Barabbas had become politically active. He was no longer just simply following the code of the Mosaic law, following the traditions. He was now no longer just coming for the Passover. He had now become a political activist. Ooh, I'm going to go somewhere right now. He had become a political activist. For every intent and purpose, he was a back in that century, a religious terrorist. The Bible even calls him a notable man. In other words, everybody knew about Barabbas. And he was arrested because he was a political insurrectionist. My God, help me. And Jesus, the real Son of the Father, is now in Jerusalem with a fake. And Pilate, God only knows how many political prisoners were in the Roman prison and jail. Why is it that it was Barabbas that was released? I want you to think about that for a minute. Tap your neighbor and say, ah, what a question, what a question. Why was Barabbas released? How interesting is this story? Watch what I'm about to tell you. Watch what I'm about to tell you. Before Pilate is ready to release Barabbas, his wife has a dream. Oh, God, be careful when your wife has a dream. Oh, come on, somebody talk to me. Come on, all you husbands go, amen, amen. Now I'm gonna give you all your ladies a chance, go, amen, amen, come on. Be careful when your wife has a dream. Pilate's wife dreams. You got to hear what I'm saying to you. And she says, I saw in my dream, Pilate, you better not let that man go for Jesus. Because she said, I heard the voice say, he's a righteous man, Jesus. But But like most husbands, is that a moan or a laugh? He didn't listen. And the main reason why he did not listen was because he needed to be politically correct. I'm going to go off of my message now and I'm going to talk from my heart. I am so sick and tired in our nation of being politically correct. Does politically correct because I want some more votes mean that I go against my conscience and I do something that is completely against the Word of God and I create a safe zone where now no longer can my child, who's a woman or girl, a female, go into a bathroom without a man standing next to her? I'll try this section over here because I ain't getting any help there. Am I going to be politically correct because I now want to redefine what marriage is between a man and a woman? Am I going to be politically correct to get more votes and not worry about my conscience and the Word of God and lower my standards to become somebody who everybody likes in my society, but I dishonor God? Don't sit there and say, I wish she should have been here. She should have been here today. She should have heard this. I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to you. Amen. Buy votes. Imagine that our nation goes to defend helpless children in Syria. And we have political activists that say, that's none of our business. It's none of your business, so shut up. If you have a precious child like that and you see a child laying in somebody's arms that's burned from head to toe and can't breathe, where is your heart and your conscience? Amen. I'll get back to my message now. So Barabbas is released. Watch this. Jesus becomes the substitute. The first person on earth that had Jesus as a substitute before he even goes to Calvary is Barabbas. Jesus is going to be punished for a man who we don't think ever became a follower of Jesus. He's released and Jesus takes his place because it was politically correct to punish the Son of God. The only thing the world didn't know is what Paul wrote to the Corinthians. He said, had the princes of this world known, I wish I heard somebody say amen with me, they would have never crucified the Lord of glory. Sometimes hidden behind the facts, hidden behind the things we can't understand, is God working out a supernatural plan, just like he's working it out in your life right now. It may look like you're in hell right now, but I've got news for you. Sunday's coming. The Lamb of God, the substitute, has come. Set you free. Barabbas, son of the Father, has now met the Son of God. Oh, you got to hear me. Is anybody getting this today? Have I taken any of you on a journey you never realized before? So the bottom line is, what are you going to do with Jesus? You just can't stay neutral. Now you know that he's the Son of God. You can't be an indecision. You cannot sit under the sound of my voice or watch me across the globe right now and think you can't do, you don't have to do anything. What will you do with this rejected Messiah? Will you reject him too? Or will you make him the Lord of your life? Will you come to realize today that he not only was the substitute for Barabbas, he is your substitute.
Amen.
He is my substitute.